Hello. My name is Larry Appelbaum. I'm in the music division here at the Library of Congress. And it is with great pleasure that I sit and I'm about to have this conversation with one of my favorite composers and trumpeters, band leaders, and educators, Wadada Leo Smith. Wadada, so nice to see you again.
Thank you.
Please,
glad to be here.
You are about to perform a concert with your Golden Quartet. Tell us, please, who are the members of this quartet?
Vijay Iyer is piano, keyboards, and mixtures. And John Lindbergh is on bass with some processing in the pedals. And Firo Nakhlouf is on drums. And sometimes he plays a little bit of percussion.
Mm-hmm. Now, there are people all over the world who would line up to play with you. Mm. Why do you choose those four? What is it about them as players or as creators?
Well, when I first made Golden Quartet, which was 2000, I guess, so just before 2000 came in, I had selected Malachi Favors, Anthony Davis, and Jack DeJohnette. And I primarily selected because I wanted to make an ensemble that had the basic outline of musical instruments, like percussion, string, and wind, and keyboard. And so I selected those guys because they were all dream players for me, okay? And we made the band, everybody was on, made the record, made some playing, and then over a couple of years, we kind of hung together, made a little bit of playing. But then one day, Malachi passed. Actually, we had played in New York at Public Library, not Public, whatever that theater called, a Public Theater. And we noticed then that he was really very sick, but we didn't know he was really sick. And so shortly after that performance, he went into the hospital and he passed. And so I said, well, maybe I'll get another bass player, you know. And then the next few days, I said, well, maybe not another bass player because I don't want to try to fix the ensemble. I want to try to start with something new. So John Lindbergh was the first guy I called, and I did him like they do the baseball and basketball players. I took him out to a big restaurant in Chicago called something like Steakhouse or something like that. And spent a lot of money on him and talked to him nice and good and made sure that he had as much steaks as he wanted. And said, you know, look, I'd like for you to play with me. And he said, yeah. And I said, oh, cool. So then I started looking around for the next piece, which was going to be piano, okay? And that took a while because I asked people, I listened to a lot of CDs of different people, and finally came down to two guys, and I'm not gonna name the other guy, mm-hmm. but I selected Vijay, and I selected Vijay because he had this nice spread in his hands, chords were like beautiful, stuff like that. And he could play ballads so nicely. And even though I didn't really play ballads, I wanted somebody that could play ballads, you know.
Did you take him to a steak dinner?
No, I didn't take him to steak dinner. You know why? He was younger. No, you don't treat the young guys like you do the old guys, you know. So. And then Shannon Jackson. Now, Shannon Jackson was older than all of us. I didn't know that at the time. I thought he was going to be younger. But Shannon and I, we just talked on the telephone for days and over and over and over, and he would tell me all his conspiracy theories about everything. And I liked that, and I said, well, that's cool. Let's try it. And so the very first time we played publicly was on a DVD that was released with Golden Quartet. That was the very first time we ever played it publicly. Mm. So it's documented on DVD. And you can see that band had great potential. But then over the time, you know, it kind of switched, and I had a couple other drummers to come through, like Nasheed Waits, and what's the other guy, Don Moyer. But then Fearon had played with me when he was like really young. You out there, Fearon? No, he was young. I mean, 19 or 20, something like that. And I always liked his playing, but we had kind of drifted apart. So I started him and Don Moyer together. And eventually, I knew it would be Fearon Akla. And this band actually, believe it or not, it excels past the other band. And you would think it's hard to believe, but not if you hear the music. You know, it's a great band.
As a composer, do you write with those specific players in mind?
I write with them in mind, and also I write in a dream state where I just write. And one is for them, and it's with them specifically in mind, and this dream state is for them, but they're not specific in mind. But I know they're in the ensemble, so it must be them.
Tell me more about this dream state. How do you achieve this state?
Well, it's like, you know, it's achievable every time you want it. Because, you know, I've been writing music since I was 12. And after that, you figure out something about how you get to the source where the music is. And you can never really tell anybody clearly how it is, but you know one thing, that you go there, because I got over 2,000 pieces, so I've been there a lot.
Let me talk a little bit about the repertoire that you will be performing tonight.
Yes.
Is this the new work, 10 Freedom
Yeah, both
Summers?
Both new works. Actually, 10 Freedom Summers, and you're only getting like a fraction, because the whole work has 18 individual pieces in it, and it takes 3 days to perform. No, seriously, it takes 3 days to perform, and six of the pieces is with a 9-piece chamber ensemble. Okay, so it's just a very large work, and it started about 14 years ago. And when I started it, I had no intention of making such a large work, but I wanted to say something about the civil rights movement that had taken place and the time in which I grew up in Mississippi. And after, you know, checking out August Wilson and his plays that covers like, what is it, 10 decades. He covers 10 decades, so I said, wow, if he covers 10 decades, then I'm going to cover 10 summers. No, seriously. And I've seen his plays, and actually, I tell you the truth about that connection. The first time that, what's the one, Black Bottom Stomp, maybe?
Ma Rainey's
Black Bottom. The first time that was premiered at the Yale Repertoire in New Haven, Connecticut. I was in New Haven, Connecticut, and one of the guys in my ensemble, Dwight Andrews, he transcribed the music for that play, and the trumpet part in the premiere and also the one in New York City is me playing the trumpet. So it's not strange that I'm twisting my life to connect with August Wilson. It was already connected on his first, on the premiere of that series of plays at the Yale Rep. And most of them were done at the Yale Rep because of Lord Richardson, who was the director there. So starting 14 years ago, this thing kind of started popping out, and some of them is on the shelf. Like, for example, one piece about the Civil Rights Movement, the Freedom Riders, called The Freedom Riders Ride, for example, that's the title of it. That was done in 2000. And so it's been about 14 years I've been collecting these pieces, and only a few has been played. Like, there's something with the duet that Jack and I did. It's called America. Those three pieces on there is from that collection. And
when you say Jack, you mean Jack DeJohnette?
Jack DeJohnette, yeah. And Golden Quartet, I think in maybe 4 years ago, recorded Bessie Ross. That's part of it. And I think that's about it that's recorded of from that whole collection.
Was this piece a commission's piece, a commission?
The new one, the part we're playing tonight, is commissioned. And the second part, because there are six pieces, maybe there's eight pieces in each collection. And this one was commissioned by Chamber Music America through the Doris Duke Society. Mm-hmm. And there's another part of the same 10 Freedom Summers section that was commissioned by the Pasadena Chamber Players. Mm-hmm. So two portions have been commissioned. Yeah.
For this music we're going to hear tonight,
mm-hmm.
where is the nexus between the composition and the improvisation?
You know, I have to answer like this, and then I can kind of explain later. It's mostly composition form, and it's mostly improvisation form. And it's mixed up in a way where sometimes you can't tell. But, and I say it that way because really, even though it's written out, each player has the opportunity to construct that line and make it have sense. Even though I give cues, the cues are floating in such a way that when the cue comes down, everybody catches it. So to do that, that's an improvisatory act already. And so that's why I say it like that. But there's lots of improvisation in, lots of improvisation, and lots of notated parts, because the whole score is about that thick, okay? And that's why it takes 3 days to play it. But tonight we have Brown versus Board of Education in 1954, and it has some other words on it, but I can't remember it. And we have the Little Rock Nine and 10 Freedom Summers, and each one of them is about something. Brown versus Board of Education really is about desegregation of school, you know, where education happens, and the Little Rock Nine shows how that was kind of implemented in a sort of strange way. And then the 10 Freedom Summers represent the killing of those warriors that were trying to register people, but it really is about their effort and the voter registration impact. Mm-hmm. And that's the portion we're playing tonight, okay? That's gonna cover the second set. And the first part is gonna be my pieces that I wrote during my Guggenheim Fellowship, which was 2009, 2010. And in that collection, there's five pieces. And the first one is there is called Dred Scott, 1865, 18-something. My head is full of a lot of stuff, but I can't remember all of them, but it's 18-something. It's on the score. If I had it, I'd read it to you. So it's Dred Scott, and you know Dred Scott opened up really the first legal debate about what race means in our society, and the notion about property rights and things like that. And he also became one of the early most noted known person because of this whole issue. So that covers a lot of areas. The second piece in there is called People of the Shahada. And that one is actually written for Malcolm X. But the people of the Shahada are very special people. They are people that come into Islam, but they come into Islam by making the confession of faith. Whereas most of the people that's in Islam today, they don't make the confession of faith. They are born into it. And the people that follow the prophet, peace be upon him, all of those people, including the prophet, they made the confession of faith. So the people in the diaspora throughout the world, they are mostly those people of the Shahada. And often people refer to them as converts and reverts. And Warren D. Muhammad said that they were people of the Shahada. So I'm following that tradition. And then next come democracy. We give a debate on democracy, musically speaking. And then after democracy comes 9/11, And after 9/11 comes Buzzsaw, the myth of the free press. Okay. And I think that's it, yeah. So that's five pieces, I believe. So that five pieces come out of that. But what I want to tell you about all of my works is that before I write them, I have this influx of ideas about them, and I take notes. But before I write them, I go and do the research. And every piece I got out of those 2,000-plus pieces, there's a narrative that goes along with what it means and how I came into to do it and stuff like that. Yeah. Because anybody can be inspired, you see. But if you do the research and put it into some kind of context, it gives that specific piece of music a meaning for being in this creation, being part of this creation.
I wish all of you could have been here for the sound check today. It's not only a chance to see them perform in sort of more informal setting, but to see Wadada pay so much attention to detail. There's this myth that we have that jazz musicians and especially free improvisers, they just get together and play. And yet I watched you.
Yeah.
And I watched you go over some specific details over and over again until everybody got it right. So here's the question. Is there a right way to play your music?
At one moment there is. The next moment it may not be. No, it's true. It's the thing that remains the same is the feeling and the emotional impact or context. That remains the same. But how it slides together, it can sometimes slide together and be absolutely right and miss that emotional or that context that it should have in it. Okay, so the moment that is correct is when it actually has finished, and then you feel that something, you know it's correct. What I be striving for in the context of making the piece have balance and coming together is so that whenever it goes into any other area, everybody would know exactly where it's at, and the adjustment is easier to like make it work out or come into the same ending. But it has to have that context first. That is the emotional impact, because you know music is about communication, and the meaning is inside of that way in which you make that connection, you know, with whoever is that's observing this event.
Well, tell me how you, literally, how do you communicate some of your wishes to your musicians? Is it overt, verbal, or is it something intuitive that you just assume they are to grasp?
Well, it's all of it. And the reason why it's all of it, because sometime during rehearsal, I'll say something about the piece. You know, but because of the way the title is fixed up, all my titles should be able to provoke some kind of thinking about what it is. You know, so that's already addressed just by the way, what the titles say. And sometimes we'll talk about, you know, what's the meaning of it. Not the meaning of the music, but what's the meaning of this piece. Okay. And, but also intuitively, any great or good, fantastic band, if you can't connect in that intuitive zone, you cannot be a great band. In other words, we know often what it is that we want to play while we're playing it, you know. And then afterwards, you know, it's like you finish, you release, you know. So there's that intuitive moment in there. And it should be always there because, you know, if you can't have this freshness about what you're trying to do, you may not be doing it.
So. For those who may just be discovering your music, I'm thinking there might be a young person out there watching this webcast. And they're just learning about you and your music. Let's provide a little bit of context. You're born in Leland, Mississippi. How did growing up in the Mississippi Delta region inform your music?
Wow, that's kind of nice to think about. I don't know if I can talk about it, but I'm gonna try it. growing up in Mississippi during the time I grew up in a completely segregated community. Okay? Blacks live here. Native Americans live here. Chinese Americans live over here. Japanese Americans live over here. Nobody mixed together. Okay? And while in fact, everybody may think that that was kind of really hard and bad at the time, but it really wasn't. You know, and don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying that segregation was a beautiful thing. What I'm saying is that the environment I grew up in, there was a certain kind of security and cultural integrity that made it so beautiful. For example, everybody enjoyed music. I played for people that would rent houses. They would come to me and ask me to go and play out the ghost that was in there before. And I would go from room to room and play the trumpet. I played in cakewalks, right in the middle of the streets and stuff like that. I was the main guy that would play taps over every dead soldier that lived in that vicinity, you know. So it was a really powerful cultural kind of connection that brought up. But the most beautiful part is that sunrise. When the sunrise come up in the Delta, it comes up out of the ground. Right out of the ground, you get that little lift of rays that come up, and then you get that little glow that come up right after that, and then you get that nice bold sun peeping out of the ground. And if you stand up in the morning and you're standing up watching that, it's like the sun is coming up out of the ground and you're taller than the sun. And as it grows up, because I was out in the fields chopping and picking and pulling and doing all these things. These are cotton and beans and all these other kind of things. And as it comes up, it measures you as it comes right on up. And at some point, it reaches right in here. And you know that sun and you are like kind of pretty powerful. And then when it moves past your head, you have witnessed something. All that goes into making art, because art is not something that's separate from who you are or what you do or how you think or how you feel. And it makes whatever you have inside of you and whatever your experience is, that's what art becomes. So growing up there, my stepfather was an artist. Everybody in my house played music. They didn't all become artists like I am, but every one of them played music. You know, my brother played trumpet. My sister played flute. One of them played clarinet. One of them sang. You know, we all played instruments. And
did you play in school?
Yes, in school, yeah.
Did you do marching bands?
We did marching band, but you see, like, I've been playing the trumpet 5 days, and I decided that I was going to be a composer. I decided that. And you know what? That's the way you do it. So I get the trumpet. Now, I think I know 3 notes or 4 notes on the trumpet, okay? But I feel like I want to compose. So what I did, I wrote a piece for 4 trumpets. I started with those 3 or 4 notes I knew, and then I got the book that had the rest of the notes in it. No, I'm serious. And I placed them here and there and here and there, and then the next thing, I went and got 4 trumpets, me, 3 other trumpets and myself. We sat down, and all of us knew 3 or 4 notes because we all had started playing at the same time. So when we get to a note we didn't know, we would stop, we'd get the book, we'd look at it, and figure out the fingering, and then we're playing. Guess what? That was the best experience in the world for me because it showed me something about music. Wherever you start in music, you only got 3 choices when you're dealing with notes. You either stay where you're at, you go up, or you go down. And that's a valuable lesson. I don't know if you know that or not, you know. So I started composing like 5 days after I started playing the trumpet. I found out that notes mix pretty well. And actually, I found out that any note mixed pretty well. I didn't know the scientific reason or the acoustical reason for it, but now I do know, and I was right. They do mix pretty well.
Does it require intent?
It requires intent, and if you look at that little narrative I just gave you, every one of them had intent in it. I wanted to be a composer. I decided to pick up some notes out of the ones I knew. I got the rest out of the book. And I went and got the group of guys to play it. That's all intent.
Do you still have that original composition?
Actually, it got lost. It got lost. Mm. But, you know, don't worry. I ain't worried about it. Because whatever you lose, it only enriches you if you actually was deep into it before. And people often give away things that they love. And those people that give away stuff that they love, they are really strong people. You know, people that give away stuff that they don't love, nothing is happening, you know.
So I'm curious how a sort of visionary, self-taught composer gets from Leland, Mississippi to Chicago and starts working with the AACM.
Yeah. Well, I went into the Army. Well, before then, I started traveling around with bands, blues bands.
Like who?
Some of them so old. I mean, so long ago, I don't know. I don't remember their names. But I can tell you, the most important one was Milton Campbell.
Little Milton.
Little Milton, yeah. And the reason I traveled with Little Milton because Little Milton and my stepfather, he kind of like studied with him. Hmm. You see. And he was a friend of the family, and my mother was the best cook probably in the history of the South.
Really? Wow.
Now, my mother was a great cook. She developed all kinds of stuff. Anyway, those guys, B.B. King, Milton Campbell, Albert King, all of them, they loved her cooking. Hmm. So they would come by. They loved my stepfather, too, but they would come by to